Finally tonight, the next in our series looking at the challenges of governing in America. In our first installment, we got some historical perspective. Yesterday, I talked with two authors who've written extensively about modern-day Washington. Mark Leibovich is author of This Town, Two Parties and a Funeral, plus plenty of valet parking, in America's Gilded Capital. And Robert Draper is author of When the Tea Party Came to Town, a look at the 112th Congress. Now, gentlemen, if you go back to the earliest days of American political journalism and satire, it featured scathing contempt of Congress and a perception on the part of the people that not enough or sometimes not anything was getting done. What's different, Robert Draper, about now?
Well, you're right that from the very outset, from the first federal Congress, you know, there was gridlock. And in fact, one guy that I write about in my book from the first federal Congress, Fisher Ames, quit in disgust after four terms, saying, do not ask what good we do. This is not a fair question in these days of faction. But back then, they managed to get the Bill of Rights passed. They managed to annex a couple of states. They stood up the executive branch, the judicial branch. They did a lot of stuff during their gridlock period. What's different at this point now is that I think that it's not only become customary, that I think the public has become increasingly immunized to it. And as Mark has pointed out in his book, it's become a profitable endeavor to do nothing.
A profitable endeavor. Mark Leibovich, the act of, quote unquote, going to Washington. Whether you're an elected official, a civil servant, a journalist, a lawyer, whatever, has that changed, let's say, just in the recent decades?
Yes. I mean, first of all, Washington has become, in the words of Tom Coburn, the senator from Oklahoma, a permanent feudal class of insiders. These are people who are in office, people who are formerly in office, staffers, journalists, hangers-on, and you have this insider class that becomes self-perpetuating, and you have a Congress that, in which 42% of former members of Congress become lobbyists, 50% of former senators become lobbyists. That compares to 2 or 3% back in 1974. So you have people coming here with no intention of going back to the farm like George Washington would have.
But is there any connection with actually achievement? If I'm going to buy politicians, if I was going to be as cynical as to put it that way,
right,
wouldn't I want to buy people who I know can really do things?
Yes, I think theoretically you could. But I also think that when people are going to go through this revolving door, as it's called, you do wonder, when people are in office, when people are in power, who are they really working for? Are they in it to actually work to serve the public good, or are they in it for self-service? So you have a situation now where the government, where the whole sort of maw of Washington has become a single entity, and if you're seen as an insider, that itself becomes marketable.
Robert, there's something charming about looking at photos of Harry Truman taking his morning stroll, surrounded by reporters popping questions at him and writing down his answers in their notepads. But one big change since then is in the media, a 24-hour atmosphere, multiple platforms, and media stars.
Yeah. And if you're asking the question, essentially, does the media bear some culpability for the situation that we're in, the answer is, I think, inarguable. Absolutely. It's become almost axiomatic that that the Washington press covers what goes on or what does not go on in as if it were an Olympic competition or a horse race. Pick your metaphor, but it's something sporting.
Yes, but part of the whole business has been traditionally pointing out dysfunction.
Right.
How do they contribute to it?
Yeah, well, they contribute to the dysfunction because they encourage people to they view everything through a political lens, not through the grimy lens of policymaking. Everything is about who's up, who's down, who had the better week, whether or not this is abetting their 2016 presidential ambitions. It's the press has always been viewed as a cynical institution, but now it's deeply so. It barely even makes a passing reference to policymaking in its coverage of political figures in Washington.
Mark, you write about a celebritized culture, and not only from people who are on TV and make millions of dollars,
right, like all
doing
of us,
so, but people who work in public service,
right,
and become kind of celebrities too. Is that new?
Yeah, it's new in that new media is new. It's new in that Twitter is new. It's new in that Facebook is new. And I do think that, look, I think we are in a business now as journalists in which the gold standard has become punditry as opposed to reporting. If you can be outrageous, if you can have a better shouting match on TV, if you can have a more, you know, attention-getting blog, you are probably in a better place. You're in a better place to succeed, to make money than other people. And frankly, it's part of a larger phenomenon in politics today in which Washington and the political class really does very, very well when nothing gets done.
So does that explain why, and you, the three of us could probably make a list with 20 or 30 names on it, of very well-known elected officials who have no singular legislative achievement,
right,
no law that bears their name, no linchpin moment in history to which they contributed, but they're famous.
Absolutely. I mean, fame itself has become the defining imperative. I mean, look at the 2012 Republican race for president, for instance. I mean, you could argue that Michelle Bachmann, for instance, to go back to sort of Robert's congressional space, is not exactly a pillar of great achievement in the House, but she became very, very famous as a sort of a cable person, as a staple in the conversation.
And she the flip side on the Democratic side, Anthony Weiner, who has been in the news a lot. I mean, Anthony Weiner was known as a talking head during the health care debate and thereafter, but he had no legislative achievement to speak of. In fact, was basically an outcast in the Democratic caucus, did very little to lift, to help either in showing up to committee meetings, crafting legislation, but he was known for being himself. He was known for being a talking head, being a
Your most recent book talks about the Tea Party specifically. Yeah. And in there and around there, sort of in orbit of the Tea Party, are a lot of public figures who point with pride to all the things that haven't been able to get done, thanks to me.
Yeah.
It's a new yardstick,
sure,
isn't it?
Well, yeah, because the unit of measurement, I think, that Democrats traditionally use is how many bills were passed. And for the freshman class of the 112th Congress, who are now now in their sophomores, the ones who are still around anyway, they say that's not the right way to measure things. Government has already regulated too much. It's already passing too many spending bills. The less, the better. So their view is that obstructionism is precisely what they ought to be doing. Gridlock is a good thing.
So where does that leave us now? Can we run a big, complicated, continent-sized country with a lot of needs using this cast of characters?
This is the part of the conversation where I put on my, I'm just a reporter, I hold a mirror to the culture hat. It's a little, I need to shorten
it's
the name.
It's the part where I defer to Mark.
Yes, I think.
We'll come up with an acronym.
No, but I mean, look, I mean, Robert and I, neither of us have chapters at the end of our books in which we lay out 10 bullet points on how we can make Washington work better, how we can make Congress work better. Ultimately, though, I think clearly there's a level of great dissatisfaction in the country with how business is and is not getting done in Washington, and it's in great disconnect with how good people in Washington seem to be feeling about themselves and how successful inside the Beltway people have become.
Mark Leibovich, Robert Draper, thank you both.
Thanks, Rick.
Pleasure.
Next week, we'll speak with people who've portrayed the nation's capital on the big screen, on television, and in novels to get their interpretation of governing in today's Washington.